Il Parco del Ticino nasce nel 1974 su volontà popolare. Ricopre una superficie di circa 92.000 acri.
Here we are in the reserve, natural reserve of La Fagiana. La Fagiana riserva orientata. This place is very important for the Ticino Park because it's a wide, very big area that is protected, and the environment and nature that is here inside is protected in the real way. Very interesting is the history of this area, because this area 50 years ago was a game reserve, was a hunting place. In fact, the lords of this place came during the weekends or during the holidays just to hunt. 40 years ago, in 74, when the Ticino Park started to exist, hunting was forbidden in this area. All along the river, hunting started to be forbidden. That's why this place hasn't had no more sense to exist. And in 1984, this place was bought by the Parco Ticino. The most important forests of this area are made by oak, hornbeam. These two species are the most important species in the original forest that was here in this area, in the Po Plain. And then there are other trees like cherry tree, or elm, ashes, or willow that grow mainly besides the river and near to the water. So the forests here are very interesting to see. And now follow me in the La Fagiana Reserve. La Fagiana Reserve is a SCI, it means Site of Community Importance. It's part, in fact, of the Nature 2000 network, that is a network of protected area in all Europe. The aim of this area is to protect nature, species, also endangered species, and also ecosystems. And this area is one of them. That's why it has an importance not only for Italy, but for the whole European Union. Here it's possible to come walking or by bike in all these roads, little roads and paths that are going in the forests. And it's possible to arrive to the river, to reach the riverbed. The reserve is managed as a natural area. It means that there are no cutting of the forests. The dead tree that remain on the soil are left there. And also there's a natural development of the forest. In Fagiana, it's possible really to see roe deer that was reintroduced by Parco Ticino in 1990 and now is widely spread. It's possible also to see some traces of the wild boar. There are many, too much probably. And also other animals like birds, like herons or egrets. Very important is this area for the birds.
Welcome everyone to Cascina Galizia, to our little family business. I'm the co-owner with my mother, and today we are here with Davide, which will explain us the preparation for a chimney fillet. Starting off from our main ingredient, the fillet, and all its preparation that we find around, from the bread crust and how it's made. It's basically 18 ounces of flour, 9 of butter, and 4 of water, which get mixed together. First, the butter, you need to mold it and make it soft, then pour the flour inside and the water to come out to this final preparation, which is basically the bread crust. The bread crust basically gets put on the fillet.
We get the egg yolk, we pass it over the fillet, we pour over some bacon or our pancetta, and then with this, with a pinball, we basically make a thin layer and we pass it over, and then end up the cooking in the oven for around 20 minutes. The fillet will remain medium rare, and the crust will get nice and crunchy. And we're now showing our beef tartare. So we have the raw meat, our Parmesan cheese ice cream, oil, salt, and pepper, which gets all mixed together, apart from the Parmesan cheese, which gets added at the end, finishing the plate. So now Davide is serving us our beef tartare that we showed you before. You see it once again on the dish with simply dressed up with some sea salt, pepper, oil, and the Parmesan cheese ice cream. Thank you, Davide. He's serving our chimney fillet. So this is the chimney part, all the fog that comes out from burning our herbs that we get from our garden. And this is how the fillet gets served.
In the 1996, Giuseppe and Giovanna Panza decided to donate the important villa and the art collection and the garden to FAI, a foundation no profit, that from 1975 is focused on the protection and enhancement of many Italian trustees. Giuseppe Panza was an important collector, curator, patron, and he collected more than 2,500 artworks in all the world. The kind of collection was a collection focused on the culture of American culture, and he began to collect from 1950 to 2000. A big part of this important art collection are conserved now in the most important international institution of art, like Salomon Guggenheim in New York, MoCA in Los Angeles, the Hirshhorn Museum in Washington. But the most important part of this art collection is conserved in Villa Panza. There are four themes that we can find in all the collection: the color, the light, the relation between architecture and nature, and the relation between the artworks and the space. But there is also a kind of fire rouge that we can see in all the artworks, but transcribed in different art languages. So we can see the beautiful monochromatic walls in relation with the antique furniture and the primitive art collection, but we can also see the beautiful minimalistic collection of Dan Flavin in the stable of the villa. Villa Panza was built at the end of the 16th century and was acquired later by different important families in the Lombardy region. But one of the most important characteristic of the villa was the relation between the architecture and nature. And this point, this element, was so important for Giuseppe Panza and became one of the most important characteristics that we can see in all these collections. FAI stage every year many activities, different activities. Sometimes we stage art exhibition of important contemporary artists and many other activities for the young people, for the family, so sometimes didactic laboratories and also some didactic experience for all the family. But we have also a beautiful and light restaurant in the villa, and so we can spend all the day in this beautiful place.
Naviglio Grande is very important for tourism in Lombardy, and also there are a lot of visitors in all parts of the world. From April to September, the visitor can visit Naviglio Grande in a part that starts at Castinetta di Lugagnano to Cuggiono. From September to October, and they start only in Turbigo. Near Naviglio Grande there are a lot of cultural elements. For example, there are Canonica of Bernate or Villannoni in Cuggiono or the Abbey of Morimondo. Visitors can combine our heritage with navigation.
I'm really proud to have the opportunity to talk about the Naviglio Grande because we can consider it really an authentic masterpiece of Italian architecture, and nowadays is still a living monument of the plain of Lombardy region. It is the oldest navigable canal in Europe. It was built at the end of the 12th century, and in about 60 years, it permitted to link Tornavento, where it takes the water of the River Ticino, and Milan. It needed three long steps of construction. In the first stage, it was possible to arrive from Tornavento to Gaggiano in more or less 10 years. And then, 40 years later, it was possible to arrive in the area that nowadays is considered the Darsena of Milan, near the Cathedral of Sant'Eustorgio. At that time, if we stayed along the canal, we could see large boats passing, and they carried any kind of products, such as livestock, sands, stones, food, and of course people going to Milan. This canal is also considered the marble route because of from the Candoglia to Milan, both carrying the marble used to build the Cathedral of Milan, Duomo di Milano, was passing here. Along the centuries, many characters of the history contributed to the canal's history. We remember, for example, the houses of Visconti and Sforza, but above all, Leonardo da Vinci. When he arrived in Milan in 1482, the Naviglio Grande just existed since two centuries, but he was in charge, among various tasks, to study the economic function of the canal, because from the water that was given to the agriculture, the municipality of Milan gained a lot of money, and Leonardo, in the Codex Atlanticus, noted that 125,000 of ducats was given to the municipality of Milan at that time. Along the canal banks, also today we can admire a lot of monuments and artifacts that are an element that justify the relationship between the canal and the life along the local municipalities. We can see mills, churches, abbeys, little historical villages, and all of them are just here and not in another place of the Lombard plain, because of there was a strict relationship between the canal life and these elements. There is a strong sense of identity for the local people living here, so that if you can enjoy the territories along the canal and you have contact with them, you can feel this strong sense of identity, and they can tell you a lot of traditions and talk about experiences and tastes of the canal.